filmmaking is an audiovisual medium. So which means it's 50% audio and 50% visual. So when we go and watch a film, we not only look at what's going on in the screen, but we also listen to what all is happening on the screen. And all the information that you hear is called the soundscape of the film. And so somebody needs to design, record that particular soundscape. Somebody needs to work on that particular sound. So it is my job and the sound department's job in general to ensure that we can hear dialogues, we can hear effects, we can hear music, and we can hear what is very popular amongst most Indian films is songs. So a picture will not be complete, cinema will not be complete if there is no sound. So somebody is there who's actually doing this job of ensuring that you are able to hear whatever you're hearing in a film. That is our job. I would like to categorize for those of you who are completely new to this field. We have always, even myself, when before I joined the specialization, when I used to go and watch a film, it always used to be the actors. It always used to be those performing in on screen. So we never really gave it a thought as to there's so much of technology behind bringing all this together. It had never occurred to me when I, as a layman, was going and watching the film. So, but slowly and gradually, you kind of realized and eventually joined that specialization. We'll come to that later. But what happens is, for those of you who are wanting to come and join this industry as a film professional, there are various departments. There is direction, there is screenplay writing, there is motion picture photography, there is film editing, and there is sound. So, and there is, of course, acting. So when you have actors performing their roles, now what do actors perform on? It is performed on something which the screenwriter has written. It's based on, I suppose, a story. Either it's a story based on somebody, or it is a story somebody's just created. So now what happens is, when somebody has created the story, when you write a book, then you need a pen and you need a paper and you write a book. When you do painting, you just need a paintbrush and some colors and you do a painting. But when you make a film, if I decide to make a film, if I want to direct a film, I will need, it is a technical medium. So I will need technology to help me put the film together. So as a director, I will want to, the cameraman will be capturing what it is my vision, okay, to make the film. But there has to be somebody to capture the visuals. Like if the actors are playing, then somebody has to record it on, record the visuals. So the cameraman is, or the DOP, the director of photography, as we now call them, he is required to, capture the moment or capture the scene, as we call it. So he does his bit of lighting and he does his bit of work, his bit of lensing, and that's his specialization. Now, those of you who are specializing in photography will want to specialize in photography. That's a different specialization. So having shot the film, while the film is being shot, there is dialogue delivery. Now the dialogues have to be recorded. So somebody has to go and record the dialogue. So who is this person? Now this is a very specialized job. So the dialogues are recorded usually either on location, or they are dubbed, which you will, this whole dubbing process you will understand later on. But somebody has to capture those dialogues. Now it's a very specialized job. It requires a trained professional. So what are the things that you need to know and how it is able to do? It is not just about going and recording like we record on an iPhone or something like that. It is not just that. It is a very specialized job. So this is what makes it professional. So we record the dialogues. Now when we record the dialogues, there are other things also that are happening. There are things like footsteps happening. There are incidental sounds like door opening, door closing, car starting, car moving, bird singing. Then if it's a very emotional kind of a scene, you will also feel that enhancement of emotion is being driven by a certain background music. So in a film, in the audio department, there are essentially three main subheadings. One is the dialogue department, one is the effects, and one is the music. Now, in effects, there are two departments again. There is the Foley and there is the atmospheric effects. And no, there are three actually. There is Foley, there is atmospheric effects, and there is incidental effects. So Foley means effects that are artificially created along with the picture, which means if there is a man walking, then you should be able to hear his footsteps. So it is very unnatural when a man is walking and you're not able to hear his footsteps. We hear it, but we don't, in real life, we hear all these things, but we don't notice them. See, this is a lockdown. And what happened in the lockdown was, a lot of us got up with a different kind of an amazement. You know, we were not used to the fact that suddenly we could hear birds singing. You know, I'm not talking about villages and countryside areas. I'm talking about main cities, metropolitan areas. I stay in Mumbai. And everybody woke up to birds singing. So these are the sounds that have always been there. So these are called atmospheric sounds. Now, these sounds were masked by us humans who are so loud because there's constant heavy traffic and horns. There are people shouting. There are hawkers. There are all these other sounds which we kept hearing every day. But we didn't realize there were also birds singing. There was atmosphere. And for those of you who stay near the sea, there is a sound of the seashore. We didn't realize that these were the sounds that are also there. So these things make up the soundscape. So when all these human noises started shutting down, then all these atmospheric sounds started coming in. So similarly, what we try and do is we simulate these sort of situations in a film. So there is always constantly an atmospheric sound, whether it's birds and bees, whether it is the traffic, whether it is hawkers, whether it is human sounds, all in a residential, typically residential area. So every area has its typical atmospheric sound. So this has to... So I should feel that if I'm looking at the actor and he's sitting in near the sea or is sitting in the railway platform, then what are the sounds that are there in the railway platform is up to your imagination to create. There are some incidental sounds like the train horns, like the trains moving, like doors shutting, car door opening, car starting. These are incidental sounds. So there are incidental sounds. There are Foley's like footsteps, pouring coffee in your cup, the sound of the coffee being poured. So these are Foley sounds that we create when the character is executing these activities on screen. So these are Foley sounds. And music is something like which enhances the mood. Suppose it's a very sad situation, either somebody has died. So there is a typical set of notes that a musician plays to make it sound very sorrowful. If it's a very romantic kind of a scene where, you know, they both look at each other, and they fall in love. And so there is a different kind of a music. Then there is something called suspense. Then, you know, you have a certain kind of a suspense or a certain selection of chords, a selection of notes that make the music sound very suspenseful, if you call it that way. So music enhances the emotion. So music is also part of the entire soundscape. Now that is one thing that is very unique to us, even today. In cinema is songs, whether it is a film in the South, whether it is a regional film, whether it is a Hindi film, there will be songs. So this is our the soundscape. This is a typical reaction, which is also the reason why a lot of people don't even know that there is a department called sound. So what happens is, when it's a story like Piku, for example. Now, Piku is not a film with any sort of an action. It's not a film with, you know, it's not a horror story. It's not all these things. It's a straight family drama. So in this particular film, it is these are verbose or dialogue-driven films. So the concentration or the information that I'm getting is mainly from dialogues. So what is important in these films is dialogues. And of course, the household and incidental sounds that are supposed to be there are there. So whatever sounds are there, they're very subtle. Like if I'm entering in Piku, when they're driving into Banaras, there is a gradual shift in the soundscape from the highway traffic. It has gone into a typical soundscape of Banaras, for example. So where you can hear temple bells, you can hear spiritual sounds, you can hear shank, you can hear the Ganga river, the water lapping and stuff like that. So these are very discreet and very these kind of sounds, but they create an atmosphere, though they're overtly, and they're not supposed to be noticed also. So it is not something that you should notice, but you should feel that you're in a part of that environment. So there is this kind of film also, which is a very quiet kind of a film. And of course, the audience will never know that there's something called sound. But where the audience understand or suddenly wake up to sound is when there is a war film, like, or there's a horror film. So what happens in a horror film, even for many of us, many of you, I don't believe in ghosts, but many of us who believe in ghosts or are afraid of ghosts, if you walk into the dark, then we do not see very well inside the dark. So our ears suddenly start hearing and noticing things. So even things like an owl screech or a creak of the door makes you suddenly jump up. So this is where the audience starts noticing sounds. In fact, they start enjoying this whole process as well. So that is when they realize that there is a process of sound that is driving you as an audience or driving the film. So similarly, in a war film, when you have a full-scale war happening in front of you, and when you have, so there is an, people notice that as well. When they notice that, you know, there are guns firing, there are soldiers fighting, there are choppers flying over your head, there are machine guns, there are, you know, flashes, explosions. So these are things that are constantly happening around you. And with today's technology, with Dolby Atmos, you can hear pretty much all the sounds all around you. Like if you can hear a chopper flying over your head. A very interesting thing about Uri is the choppers were never there. These were created by VFX or computer graphics or animation. So when they were creating these choppers, how they would fly, whether they'll fly over you like this, whether they'll fly in front of the screen and above your head, whether they'll go across the screen. So these are the movements that were being composed by the graphic artist and the in combination with the director and the cinematographer, the DOP. So now you have to bring life to that animated character. So that is where we come in. So this is where I start, you know, researching what kind of chopper is that model based on. Is it an Apache? Is it a Bell chopper? So they all have their distinct sounds. What kind of guns are they using? Is it a semi-automatic? Is it an AK-47? Is it a 9mm? So they, all these guns have a distinct quality of sound, which you should be aware of. And what happens is then we start laying these gunshots and we start processing these gunshots to make it sound much more impactful. So it's a very intricate job. And in Uri, for example, you could hear the starting scene itself, you would hear, you would see an explosion. The film starts with a guy singing in the bus. They're happy coming back from some kind of a encounter. And suddenly they are ambushed. So when you see that particular ambush, you will realize that, you know, we are all taken up with that. It starts with the expanse of the forest, which is supposed to be the northeast. Now, in reality, we could not shoot in the northeast or Kashmir or Himachal in those areas because of they are sensitive zones. So there, you cannot physically go and you know, shoot over there because your life is at risk, your crew's life is at risk, and then you don't know, there may be some accidents. You may be giving out something which the intelligence people don't want you to give. So they don't allow shooting easily on in those places. So the shoot was done in a country called Serbia. Now, the visuals that we are seeing is all in Serbia, but our Indian audioscape is very different from what the audioscape or the soundscape in Europe or in the USA. So we had to make it convincing that it was the Himalayas and it was a tropical forest. So we were work very detail in a very detailed way of the kinds of birds that are going to be singing in the forest, the kind of experience that you would have when you walk into a very densely dense forest in the northeast. So, and in between that, you can hear the faint sound of a soldier singing, and which suddenly gets broken by a tire blast, by a tire puncture. So it shocks us that, oh, you know, it suddenly takes you into that thing. What just happened? So then we kind of go as along with the film, and the driver gets down to see, and then he sees that there are nails on the road that have been thrown. And that is the time when we realize that this is not just a tire puncture, but it is an ambush. That is where the music starts. That is where that, oh my God, wala feeling comes in, that, okay, there is something which is not right. And by the time you realize what is happening, the driver is shot. You can hear a bullet flying from your surround speakers into the front, and the driver gets knocked off, and there's a firefight that follows, followed by a major explosion. And then again, the film gets into another wave of, and then that's how the film progresses. So this is how that entire scene was very sound driven. Without sound, it would not have been possible to create that particular scene. A lot comes from imagination. A lot comes from research as well. So in research, like there was a film that I worked on recently, which has not been released yet in a big way. It was a small film, but it was a very interesting film. The name of the film was Chintu Ka Birthday. I don't know if some of you may have caught it on television, or not television, sorry, in film festivals. So this film is inside one house. The story is based on a family who is stuck in Iraq, in Baghdad, during the first the first Gulf War. So the story revolves around a family, an Indian family, who got stuck over there because of some bureaucratic goof-ups. And that particular day happens to be this boy, Chintu. This family is father, mother, the nani, the sister, and the younger brother. This is the family who is there. They are stuck in Iraq because of the of some bureaucratic hassles regarding their papers. So that particular day happened to be Chintu's birthday, and the story was they wanted to celebrate Chintu's birthday, but Chintu unfortunately could not go to the school because the school was bombed and the invasion had started. So it was not possible to step out of the house. And but the father decided that, you know, today that we will try and make this birthday very interesting. We'll bake a cake for Chintu. So they try in whatever way to entertain Chintu and not make him feel that his birthday is going to go waste. So it's a very interesting film with a little bit of humor and stuff like that. But the whole thing, there's a constant dark reality that was also there. So the reality was that in that grave situation where your house could be bombed anytime, where there is fighting outside, there are helicopters flying, there are machine guns, that muted machine guns, there are car bombs going off, there are people screaming on the streets. So these are things that are mutedly happening constantly around Chintu's birthday story. So I had to imagine what the scenario would be. So my research or my since I come from a generation, the early 90s, where we actually started seeing for the first time the satellite televisions open up in India. And many of you, I mean, not many of you, the students will not know, but I was watching CNN with utmost interest. Number one, because it was a very new thing that there's a news coverage straight from the battlefield. Then the technology of warfare was very different from the conventional wars that we have seen so far, or the footage of wars that we have seen so far. It was, you know, people were sitting at in their respective offices and firing missiles from there. So that was a very new thing for that. And I remember in that whole process, there were these American Humvees that would travel through the cities with a loudspeaker on top, which would announce in Arabic to announce to the people to stay indoors or not come out because they didn't want to have any civilian casualties. So there was this constant loudspeaker that would announce in Arabic, asking people to clear out and stay indoors and don't come out and go and, you know, be safe. And those kind of constant hammering of announcements that were happening. This is something which went into my subconscious because I didn't realize that it was there. But in the film, I realized that that was a track that had to be there. Luckily, I asked my dubbing coordinator, like, I need somebody who can speak Arabic. So she found one Arabic student who happened to be from Iraq and who remembered the war as a kid. So he came and he started announcing the way that they were announcing. And I filtered that process. I made this voice sound like it is coming from one of those megaphone and car kind of speakers. And constantly it was happening in the background. So that added to a little bit of, that added to the tension that was around. So whenever there was a scope that those things would get a little louder, again, they would withdraw. Or there would be an occasional muted kind of a chopper that would go. When the door opened and there were two American soldiers, there were two American actors in that. So they, when they stepped in and how outside the door, they had a kind of a firefight. You could not see the enemy, but you could see the guns fighting and these guys fighting back. And then they come inside and say, shut the door. So this entire atmosphere of war, throughout the film, the audience were convinced that they were in a city like Baghdad, but at the same time, they were not being, but it had to, you have to create a balance that, you know, people don't get distracted by what all is happening outside. What is important is the drama inside. I have never been to Iraq. And imagine the amount of money they saved by not going and shooting in Iraq just because of us, the sound people. It is a combination of both. See, there are people who come with various backgrounds. You know, there are, I may have a lot of interest in this, but I, in sound design, but I may feel that, okay, I don't have a science background. Can I do it? Yes, you can do it. And so it does not depend on whichever background that you come from. You must understand that there is going to be a little bit of technology, a little bit of physics involved. And mostly it is going to be class 10 to class 12 physics, but not the intricacies of physics that you will learn, hopefully, in the institution. Shayan, the HOD, is a wonderful teacher. And so what happens is you will need to know the basics. Now, if I draw an analogy, that if I were to own a car, if I'm going to buy a car, I would have to learn how to drive that car. Now, the driving part is the technical part. You have to understand what is the steering. You have to understand what is the brake, what is the clutch, what is the gear, what is the accelerator. You need to know these basics. You don't need to know the functioning of a petrol engine. You don't need to know the functioning of a diesel. You don't need to know the functioning of how the batteries are wired. You don't need to know the electrical wiring of the car. You don't need to know that. So it is, what we are doing is we are utilizing that technology as an application. So in sound also, so what happens is you have to be comfortable. But the only technical side that you have to understand is you have to know from your meter whether the battery is down or not, whether your handbrake is up or not. How do you learn how to drive? So you have to learn the car in such a way that when you're driving, your hand automatically goes to the gear and shifts the gear to, you know, first gear, second gear, neutral, or if you're going back, reverse. And how do you leave the clutch gradually and press the accelerator gradually at the same time in order to set the car in motion? These are things that you need to learn in your driving school. Then you can concentrate on the journey. Then I can say that, okay, I'm driving to Goa, or I'm driving to wherever. So then the journey becomes much more interesting and you're not locked down with the mechanics of the car. So having said that, I would want to say that learning the process of recording involves a certain technology, certain amount of technology. It involves a certain understanding of sound as an energy. It involves understanding magnetism. It involves understanding electricity. It involves understanding acoustics. So these are some of the things that you need to understand: what a microphone is, how a microphone functions, what a speaker is, and how do you wire them. You have to understand, most of you understand what a computer is because you're born in that generation, Vandana, especially your generation, you're born into it. So you have grown up with in a non-linear environment. So you understand the whole process. So for you to adapt to a slightly different zone is not going to be very difficult. So the process of recording, there's a whole process of recording, understanding the whole, what is a microphone, what is a studio, where, what are the specialized kind of microphones, what are the types of microphones that you need to use for what things. Like for dialogues, you need a particular microphone. For recording songs, you need a particular microphone. For vocals, you need a particular microphone. And there are certain microphones which are good on drums. There are certain microphones which are good on guitars. There are certain microphones which are good when you're going out and recording effects. So how will you know what these microphones are? First of all, you have to understand what is the basics of a microphone. Then what are the types of microphones that are there? So these are things that Chandeep and the sound department is going to impart to you. So you have to understand what is it that you're working on. So gradually, you will also get to know what is sampling, what is digital. You will slowly get to know. I would say do not be intimidated by the fact that, oh, it's too technical a medium. It is not too technical a medium. It's how you look at it. And once you understand these, then there are, of course, you're going to be constantly upgrading yourself. There are seminars which most of these companies who, like we work on workstations like Avid, Pro Tools. So there are always seminars and exhibitions where we are constantly updating ourselves with the new technologies that are coming in. Especially my generation, for me, it is, for us, it is a complete revolution. In fact, from a very different background and a very different technology, we have stepped into the digital technology, which was very different from our way of functioning. But what will never change and what will always remain analog is the process of recording. So only the medium has changed, but the process of recording will always remain the same. So nowadays, with work, like earlier, we used to physically cut film or cut tapes in order to make an edit. You'll understand what edit is when you join the institute. So today you can do that on the computer. Back in the day, we didn't have that godsend button called undo. So if you made a mistake, it was your job was on the line. Today you can just press the undo and not worry about it and go ahead and do the whole thing again. So what I'm trying to say is there is definitely for people who come from a science background or who have understood, or people who have come from a music background, definitely they will be able to catch on a little faster. But for those who haven't, you have to put in that little extra effort to understand that little bit of science that is involved in this medium, because it is a technical medium, whether you go in for camera, whether you go in for editing, whether you go in for sound. So yes. And talking about the Dolby Atmos, it's a very fascinating, we are living in very fascinating times, because earlier we used to have a limitation that we used to record sound on film. It had a very narrow dynamic range, so that, and we had just one mono speaker to listen to the whole thing. It was fun back then. We understood and it served a kind of a purpose. When sound first came into cinema, that was also a different story. You can always read about it and check that out. So every step has its technology. So it is not that, you know, today, if somebody told me that, can you go and work like that? I will feel a little limited because I'm so spoiled with all this new technology and all the stereophonic sounds and the atmospheric sounds that are coming that I'm really enjoying the process today. And what is happening is there's a lot of importance being given. Like today, it is the final stage in the film. When the film comes out, just before the film is released, the final stage is the sound post-production stage. That time we are like worshipped by everybody. Then later again, they forget about us. That's another story. But then you wait for another film. But you have to understand what is, the basics. You have to understand, you have to keep reading. You have to make yourself aware. You have to understand what is, if you don't know or if you have not done music, start learning about it. Not particularly learning music, but at least learn what kinds of music there are around you. What kinds of sounds there are around you. What are sound effects? Because there's so much on the net today that you can absorb yourself. You can absorb all this from the net for your awareness. But let me tell you one thing. This is, the net does not mean that reading online will immediately make you a specialized person. No, little knowledge is dangerous. We all know that. You have to go through a whole process because the filmmaking process is a practical process. So the proof lies in the pudding. Unless you have tasted it, you will not know what it is, how much of sugar, what is the flavor, you will not know. I can tell you all about it, but you will not understand unless you have actually eaten the pudding. So what I'm trying to tell you is that all these information that you get online is going to help you create a certain awareness in you. But for specialization, then you need to, once your mind is made up, then you can always join in for the specialization. It's fun, it's more interesting there. You know, try and build this awareness. Try and do a lot of reading about the process. There are a lot of informative videos on YouTube. Well, what is the process of filmmaking? How, what is screenplay writing? What is motion picture photography? So you'll find a lot of these educational videos, usually free, uploaded by a lot of individuals. A lot of amateur filmmakers have done it. So what I'm trying to say is you have to be aware that this whole process is an art. So you have to understand not just the sound, you have to understand the whole process of when you watch a film, go and see a film, but this time don't watch a film like an audience. That don't watch a film to, your first viewing, you may see the film like a regular audience and you may like it or may not like it. Second time, go watch the film again. And then you will start noticing things. When you are suddenly aware, you will start noticing things. Like I tell a lot of people, I tell them that, you know, close your eyes every morning and just listen to what your environment sounds like. You'll be surprised by the information that is coming in. And it is coming into our subconscious. There is somebody's television is on. There is a hawker that is coming. There's somebody selling onions. There's somebody in Hyderabad, very interesting, I found, was an auto rickshaw which had a megaphone on top, which was looping. You know, they put a pen drive and it was looping about how, you know, come and buy my onions, basically. So it saved him his voice, and he's utilizing technology in order to, spread the message that I'm here. So it's very unique to Hyderabad. Then if you walk into go to a city like Kolkata, then what strikes you immediately are the trams. So trams were initially there long ago in places like Mumbai and other cities. But today only Kolkata has a city which has got trams. So the sound of the tram bells and all that is very typical to that particular city. So what I'm trying to say is these are things that you have to be now conscious about. You have to start, you have been hearing it, now you have to start listening. So you have been seeing things, but now you have to start noticing. So when you're a cameraman, then you see what kind of lighting is happening, what is the time of the day, what is the light, how harsh is the light. When you're sitting out in your house, what is the kind of a lighting that you have in your house? What is the, you know, these are things that you start noticing, not just even as a sound. If I'm going to specialize in sound, there are these other elements are always, it is going to have an influence on my work. So the kind of songs that you're going to listen to, you must listen to music. What is jazz? What is rock? What is Hindustani classical? What is Karnatak classical? Try and understand what instruments are. What is a flute? What is a sitar? What is a veena? What is a guitar? What is a drum? What is a mridangam? What is a pakhavaj? What is a tabla? So these are things that you, when you're hearing a song, me as a professional, we used to have in our school, in our film institute, we used to have listening exercises. So you're not just listening to a song. You are, at the same time, you should know how many instruments are playing. So you have to understand there is a guitar playing, there is a vibraphone playing, there is a keyboard playing, there are some violins playing, there is a voice, there is a tanpura playing, there are these percussions playing, there is a drum playing, there is a tabla playing. So these things will automatically come to you. So this is how sharp you must train yourself to be. And you can start now, whether you join the school or not as a professional, whichever side you go to, whether you go into direction. And for a director, it is all the more important to understand these things. So whichever specialization you go into, these are things that you have to understand. These are things that will be part of your daily life. You have to get up. It becomes a part of your character. When you join a military training academy, the cadets who come out, who have passed out, even in civilian life, they carry themselves as though they are being they have been trained to, you know, their walk becomes like a march, their haircuts are short, the way they sit is very erect. You know, there is a certain discipline that they have been conditioned to. And that automatically happens. Even if you don't think about it, you will sit like that, you will walk like that, you will talk like that. So this is what the army schools do to you. These are what army training places do to you. Same thing with any educational institution. When you're enrolling into a film school, and when you have come out, there are these things that will stay all your life with you. So you will carry this database into your head. The situations will be interesting because every day there will be a different story. There will be a different application. That is the interesting part of it, as opposed to a typical bank job where you go in the morning, open your accounts, and then I'm not demeaning them, but I'm just saying that for a person like me, something like that would be very monotonous. So it's very interesting to create, to think about a soundscape, to create a soundscape. If somebody's given me a story, I would like to create things around it and make it a little more interesting. So you have to open your minds. You have to start understanding. You have to start listening. You have to go to the museums, go to art museums, look at paintings, go listen to music, go to concerts and watch many, many films. Keep watching all kinds of films, even the most boring ones, watch them. Nowadays, with all these Netflix and Amazon and all these OTT platforms, you have much more this thing. But be aware that there are people making various kinds of cinema all around the world. It is not just what our Bollywood or Tollywood or Hollywood releases. So there are so many types of cinema that is going on. And if you get to see somebody who's made a film in France, or somebody who's made a film in Brazil, or somebody who's made, you know, countries, a lot of films are made in countries that even we have not heard of. But they all have a story to say. And you realize that there are very, and you can connect to those stories. It does not matter whether it's a different country or a different language. So you have to watch these films. You have to understand. Then slow that adds to the theory or the practicals that you're doing in film. These are things that will constantly shape your sensibilities. I'll give you an example on this, but first I'll let you know that a director is expected to know everything about filmmaking. He's a guy who's conceived it. Now there are various departments. Now I may have a particular way, again deriving an analogy over here. If I were to make a house, I have a certain thing in mind. But I am not going to be able to go and make that particular house. I will need the help of an architect. This architect is going to give me various options, and it is going to make the house according to my taste, what I would want. And he will usually make it better because there are a lot of angles, a lot of perspectives that he has that I, as a person who wants to build this house, may not have. But I know the kind of house I want. So the director knows the kind of film that he's going to make, but it is often very surprising for him when we come out with ideas that qualify his vision, that qualify his story or his, you know, whatever he's intending to make. So there may be a particular shot that you might take, but what will happen is, suppose if you give the director of photography that, okay, can you make this shot a little more interesting? So I will probably throw light from a particular angle, make it a little dark over here, and you know, that could be one look. Or my back could be lit up and I'm in complete darkness. That also gives a different kind of a mood. We call it a silhouette. So this particular story, and suppose you require a silhouette, it sets the mood. So similarly in sound also, what happens is the director knows. Like, I'll give you the example of Bajirao Mastani. So Bajirao Mastani, the director did not come and underline every detail that I should use in terms of sound. If there were things, when he would come, when I was ready with my sound, he would come, Sanjay Mansali would come, and he would look at it and he says, you're 99% over there. I just need little this and little that. So I have to make sure that I have put it all together. So when he comes and presides over it, then he might want to say, can we try this or can we try that? Because he's also constantly creating. So when you have brought it to a particular level, then he kind of makes it a little more relevant to his thinking. I may have a vision, he may have a vision, but eventually he's the director. So he wants to mold it a little according to his perspective. And then you realize why he's saying that, because there are other factors which he wants to highlight as well, which the sound is doing. Now, one example would be, I give this example in many classes, master classes and all that. It is that this is a story of a Peshwa, Bajirao, and the timeline, you know, it's a period film. So in his time, the Bajirao Peshwas were basically Brahmins who were appointed by Shivaji Maharaj to govern the various states that Shivaji had conquered. There were no states, and they were like, you know, they would go all the way to Rajasthan, Kolkata, south. So Shivaji had a very vast empire. Now, they needed people to, like governors today or chief ministers today, to run that particular area or that what we call states today. So those were the regions that these Peshwas were supposed to govern. Now, these Peshwas were Brahmins. Why Brahmins? Because they were the only ones who were literate, who knew Sanskrit, who knew accounts, who knew governance, who were educated, basically. So that's why these were supposed to be Brahmins. Now, Bajirao was one such Brahmin who turned into a warrior king. So his ways were not Brahminical. He was very unorthodox. He would fight. He would drink. He married a Muslim. These were very unheard of in a very orthodox Brahmin background that he came from. But a large part of the film revolved around his house, which is called Shanivar Pet, which is still there in Pune today. So what would a typical household, Brahmin household, what would be the sounds around the typical Brahmin household? So I did my bit of research and I found out that there is this place near Panchgani in Maharashtra where Brahmins from all around Maharashtra, they come every year around August and they chant the Veda. So I wanted to record 20-25 Brahmins chanting the Veda. I wanted that to carry in the film. I wanted to use that in the film. Now, this is something the director never thought of, but I was very intent on trying to get this. Then in that same exercise, I found some 10, 12 ladies. The youngest of the ladies was probably 70 years old. So these beautiful senior citizen women sitting, and they were singing old Marathi bhajans. Now, I specifically wanted the Vedic chant by these Maharashtrian Brahmins because the story was based in Maharashtra. Because when you have Veds chanted in the south, it has a very south kind of a flavor. If you see Banaras, it has a very north kind of a flavor. The way Sanskrit is pronounced in Maharashtra is also very different. Instead of Sanskrit, they say Sanskrut. So little things like that. So it has a kind of a flavor. Now these things were there in the background. People may not have noticed. They were not supposed to notice. But it created an atmosphere. Sanjay Bhansali loved it. He said, this is, and I use the women bhajan, singing bhajan in Kashibai's new room where she is showing Bajirao that, you know, this is our new room. And I wanted to put that sort of bhajan coming from the temples aside. So it had to be a Brahmin house had to be spiritual. There had to be 10 sounds of the temple. There had to be sounds of course, a lot many more birds and peacocks and stuff like that. Horses, because the stable was close by. And these spiritual sounds which were driving this whole Brahmin household, because there would be prayers, there would be constant bhajans, there would be, you know, the whole lifestyle is very spiritual. So that is something that they were constantly expected to do. So that was my research. First of all, I'd like to clarify one thing. A lot of people think that sound design is basically background music. They don't even know that there's something called sound design, that there are sound effects happening. They understand if you say, I've done the music for that film, then they'll know, they'll immediately relate to you. That music is something that people think is the, so even the background sounds that are happening, people say that, you know, what a fantastic background music it was. So they are two different things. Like I told you earlier, there's dialogue, there's effects, there's music, and there are songs. So music is a part of sound design in a film. So music is also a very specialized subject. Music is a, and you should not be under the impression that you are applying for a music product, music course. You know, this has to be very clear that it, even if you want to be a professional musician or a composer, you are still welcome because it is also another art form. This course will help you understand the technicalities of it. Like suppose you want to become a music director after this, you want to become a composer after this, you're welcome to do that. But what you will carry in from this institute is you will know how to record, you will know what equalization is, how to process, how to design your music. These are things, the technical information that you gather will help you as a composer or as a music producer. But this is not a music production course. Please do not confuse yourself with that. There are other schools for music where they teach you what is music, what is songs, how do you compose music, what is chords, what is raga, what is note, what is, you know, those kind of things. So that is a different specialization. You have to know, I mean, there will be a kind of an understanding of music while you're recording songs or when you're recording music in the studios in the institute. You will, that will be your interaction with music. So this has to be very clear in your minds. So, but music is something that everybody works with. The director works with music. Suppose he's making a documentary on Ustad Zakir Hussain, for example. So the director has to do his bit of research in Hindustani classical. He has to do the research of, or if he's doing it on Pandit Shiv Kumar Sharma, who plays the santoor, or if he's doing it on Lata Mangeshkar, for example. So the director should be very well informed about what are the kind of songs that they sing, what is the kind of specialization of the music that they do. So the director has to understand what music is. Suppose the director is making a particular film where a certain type of music is needed. Suppose he wants a jazz background, or suppose he wants a rock kind of a background. If he's making a film on a, or say like they made a film on like you're making it on a rock band, for example, you have to understand that genre of music. So you have to understand what kind of music. The directors will have to understand that what does he want from the music. So at the same time, so therefore his bit of research has to be what is the kind of music that you're doing, what is the kind of music that is required, and what is the kind of music that you should listen to, or what intrigues you, what excites you, and therefore you carry that particular thing. A lot of people like to use folk music. So folk is another form of music that you would want to employ for your kind of a subject, for example. Where you're making a film on tribals and then you want certain tribal melodies coming over there. You may improvise on that. You may modernize it a bit. You may make it a little more contemporary. But your base is folk music. So your selection. So if the director says, this is what I'm wanting. So as a sound designer, I understand that, okay, this is what they're looking at. And you are also thinking on those lines. If I can go and record those folk musicians on location, then what is going to be the, then I can utilize those tracks in certain scenes in the film. Or I can discuss with the music director and together we can, and give him, I can give him these samples and probably he makes something out of that. And together we decide, okay, this is what we are going to do in the soundscape. Coming to Chokerwali, which was the first film, incidentally, that that I was doing sound design for. Because before this, I was specializing in song and music recording. Devdas, the project, the film was released. And then from that, I decided that I didn't want to be just restricted to only the music field. I also wanted to explore how we can design. Because a lot of design happened by way of music. And I did a lot of design in Devdas with the musical elements being music engineer. I also did a lot of work over there. And from that, I realized that, you know, they are all interconnected and woven so much. So if I were to take the charge, and I am very fortunate doing that because it's not very easy. Like a lot of people specialize only in music recording. A lot of people do only location recording. A lot of people only do dubbing. A lot of people only do film mixing. A lot of people only do track laying for what they call design, sound design. But I am able to do all of that today, which I always wanted to do. Now, the part of the reason why you cannot do all of it together at this time is because you need to specialize, I feel, in a certain environment, or it also does not give you the time. Like Vandana, if you're doing location shooting, simultaneously the edit is going on and simultaneously you need to do the sound design, you will not be able to pluck yourself out of the location and come and supervise your design. You will need either a partner or you will need somebody else to overlook, oversee that aspect. So the work is shared because of the timeline pressures. And for me, what I have done is I have been able to form teams which are handling these various departments. And so that is how I have divided myself. Now, coming back to Chokerbali, the music part, when we were thinking of doing, because it is a Rabindranath Tagore story. So when we decided to do background music, then we were trying various things. The composer, very brilliant composer, Devajyoti Mishra, who used to assist Salil Chaudhary. And he was a composer of that. And very senior composer now, our contemporary. He was trying various styles of, you know, music for the background and things like that. Then you realize that, you know, this music is not working. It's sounding typically that sort of a thing. Then I kind of sat with Ritu Porno Ghosh. And we said, since we are doing a story on Tagore, why don't we utilize Tagore's music, rich music base as music track for this particular film. And we did it with a difference. So we recorded, you know, all these Tagore songs in various ways and in instruments and vocals. I got some 35 Rabindra Sangeet singers singing in harmony. And then we went to Chennai. I wanted, because it was a regional film and they were afraid of, you know, and there was a budget issue. So then I pestered Ritu Porno and the composer, okay, let's go to Chennai and record the violins, you know, because we need this richness in the track. And finally, the producer agreed. And when it was recorded, it was sounding so rich. And then the whole getting together, the whole music ensemble itself was another task. It was another design. Then, of course, Banaras. Now, Banaras again came from memory because I had been there as a kid, but I had not been there as an adult at that point. I've been to Banaras several times after that, but it so happened that I was not, and they had already shot the Banaras scene. So I had to recreate the sounds of Banaras again. So I got various, and again, there are a lot of these things. I had the spiritual pundits from, you know, UP, from Bengal, and Banaras is a place which is like, you know, people from all over India come, and it's almost like a gateway to another world. So it has a very magical and a spiritual effect, and that was what we were trying to create always as a backdrop when the Banaras parts of the film were coming. There's a Telugu film that I'm working on currently, very interestingly. And initially the producer was wondering what is Gasly's, so he was paying me without knowing who he's paying. What is he paying for? So, because they're so used to, you know, background music and some incidental effects. So what is this sound designer guy? Who is he and where has he come from and why am I giving him so much money? So slowly after seeing a part of the film, he realized that what we were doing. So it is also mostly in regional films. We have moved on a lot in Hindi cinema, but many regional films, this is still the norm. So when the hero is fighting, there is a constant music going on. And I'm trying to tell the director, who's understanding very well this whole process, and I'm telling the director, why are we accentuating the fight scene with music? It almost sounds like he's doing Kathakali instead of a fight. So the music has to be there like a pulse while the action or the dynamics of the fight comes out. Which, if you see the film Uri, you will see most of these hand-to-hand combats or the war sequence, the music comes in and goes, but it supports, it does not clash or interfere with the fight scene. So when the hero is doing the fight, there's suddenly a different kind of a music which is going dun 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 dun. And for me, I'm trying to tell them, boss. So it is a sensibility. It is something the music director has been conditioned to. But slowly when I sat with the music director, it's easy here in Bombay because we all know each other. It's a small industry. So when I'm telling the music director, let's not have too many percussions in this very busy fight scene, whether it is in war scene, whether it is Bajirao, whether it is Uri, there's going to be a lot of clutter. In Bajirao, it was swords and the neighing of horses, the horse hooves, the people shouting. So the music has to combine these instead of making it very percussive. So you have percussive elements in the music, it will clash with all these things. Similarly, in Uri, when you have bullets, when you have people, when you have this machine gun thrust in your face, there'll be dynamics of that particular sound. There'll be explosions. So you don't qualify all this with your da-dan, da-dan music over there because it'll kill that. And neither the music will be heard nor the effects will be heard. So you have to understand what is spacing and how you should design track or design your soundtrack. And you should have a good equation with the composer because he's supposed to bring out the emotional element in that. So in this particular Telugu film, I had to do it very delicately because I did not want it to seem like I'm entering his space and things like that. So slowly we became very good friends and he understood what I was saying. And he also started evolving and coming out with some fantastic stuff. So these are things, these are equations that you have to understand that when music is playing a part and how much of it you want to, how much should the music come in? So I believe that music should come in waves. Like, you know, suddenly you flourish in terms of music and then you go back again and then effects comes in. So it is very important to know when not to give music in a particular scene. So that is one thing. Art may, we have this. Now in mainstream also, we are trying to bring in that sensibility. Today's generation, they are being brought up a lot. They are much better informed and they are always looking forward. People are constantly looking forward to, you know, their demands are becoming much more. You cannot fool them with some, okay, do this. But they will see that, you know, it is not the right quality or not the right sound. They are fully capable of making these observations. So you are now addressing a much better informed audience. It does not matter from which society he comes from. We are trying to bring this into the mainstream and trying to make it sound better. And people are loving it. People loved, so they have enjoyed the music also. They have enjoyed the combined cinematic impact that this has, that sound is created for that particular scene. So much of this thing that people have sat down and they have noticed, because when the firing in Uri was going on, I wanted to have those empty bullet shells fall around you. So it made the person feel like he's sitting and shooting and these bullet shells are falling around you. It made the audience feel that they were in the war. And the music was also contributing emotionally in wherever they are. But ideally for me, a background score or a music should not be noticed. It should be felt. So where the effects has come in, where music has taken over, that depends entirely on how the film is designed, the visual, how it is shot, how it is edited. And that also reflects on how we design the sound. And what we also do is, usually when there's an edit jerk or when there's a visual jerk or when there is computer graphics happening, sound comes in and, you know, kind of mends all the flaws. It covers all these other things and makes it, apart from making it much more interesting, it also covers a lot of areas where, you know, it's such a vast, filmmaking is such a vast process that there could be some errors here and there. So they get covered up by this and it does not seem like an error anymore. There is never a silent moment, not in film, not in our lives. When you shut your eyes, the camera closes. You can't see anything, but your ears don't shut. Even when you're sleeping, your ears don't shut. You are constantly hearing sounds. This is something which is, this is designed for our survival. Because if we are sleeping out in the wild, what will wake us from our sleep is a sound of a wild animal that is about to attack you, or, you know, these are elements that is for our survival. So sound never sleeps. There is never a silent moment. You must understand this, because how you can prove it is you set an alarm before waking up. So that means if you can hear the alarm in your sleep, it means your sound is on. You have set an alarm for 6 a.m. So 6 a.m. the alarm goes off and then you wake up from your sleep. So your hearing is constantly on and it affects your dreaming process also. So it is very interesting to understand that, you know, when you're having a not very comfortable sleep and this alarm goes off, there is a very tentative moment between you waking up and you're half awake, half asleep kind of a moment. I'll give an example. The film is Madras Cafe. Now, if you see Madras Cafe, there is a John Abraham. He's become an alcoholic because he blames himself for not being able to save the politician who was killed. So he blames himself for this entire process. So what happens is he's in that whole alcohol and his hangover and his disturbed sleep. He hears the sound and he hears all these battle sounds. He hears, you know, suddenly there's a chopper that goes whoom, it goes and he wakes up. And in reality, there is a chopper which is flying in a distance in the Himalayas where he is now settled down. So this is how I had connected this particular film. It was not thought of like that, by the way. So it was something which we made the connection. I made the connection for him to get up and link the chopper which is flying in a distant sound with birds singing and things like that. And that is that is the effect that you have. This is what he's waking up to the reality, which is a morning effect of birds singing and stuff like that. Now, this I'm saying in context of our hearing, which is constantly on even in our sleep. There is never a silent moment. If you keep, you know, when you don't hear human sounds, it is perceived as silence most of the time. When nobody is talking in the room, everybody is saying the room fell silent. The room is not silent, boss. There is always some sound. There is sound of the air conditioner. There is a sound of the fan. There is somebody working in the kitchen. There is your mom cooking in the kitchen. There is somebody watching television in the house. There is somebody, kids playing in the park. There are birds singing. So all these are constantly there. It's just that you are so engulfed in your thought at that moment that you don't notice these particular sounds. That's how the human mind always works. So in reality, there is no silence. But you will first be hit by this silence when you walk inside a recording studio. Because all these sounds that you have taken for granted suddenly stops. So then that sound of silence actually wakes you up. That makes it becomes louder, it becomes harder to
take it.
The silence hits you harder than the sound itself. Because it is, you can call it psychoacoustics, whatever it is, but it is mainly the way our minds work. So we are not naturally used to a very dead and a quiet environment. And also you may get a giddiness. If you walk into this sort of an environment with absolutely no sound, you can almost hear your ears ringing. It may make you very giddy because what happens is sound also gives you a perspective. When you are talking, your voice reflects off the immediate environment. So even when you close your eyes, you can make out that, you know, you're either in a church or in an empty room or in a room full of furniture or in a closet or in a bathroom. So your ears will give you the information where you are. So we are constantly hearing. There is no silence. And in film, again, I'll go back to Uri. The film starts off with the bird singing and there's a constant atmospheric sound and stuff like that. I have played with a little bit of silence when there's a realization that there are nails on the road which has created that, you know, which was the reason for this tire puncture. And there was a brief moment of silence. And that little silence with the slowly, the music coming in slowly and, you know, giving us a sense of, oh, is this an ambush? This looks like an ambush. Before you realize that it's an ambush, suddenly you have bullets coming. So it is and when the bullets start coming, that time you get, I wanted the audience to feel shocked. Not necessarily with the loudness of the sound, but with the particular sound. Like, you know, in a very quiet environment, in a very quiet, dark kind of a room, if you suddenly hear a mouse squeaking, that also can give you a lot of shock. It need not be a huge explosion. So your mind is not ready for this. So your mind perceives it as a huge shock. So we play with silences actually. When we are creating, when the next scene is going to be like really elaborate and really heavy, I try to create a particular silence because it, you know, wakes you up. It startles you. At the same time, it should not take you away from the story. So there has to be a reason also for why you're, why there has to be a sound. Like this calling bell that you heard. It disturbed all of us. It disturbed me speaking. It disturbed you talking. Because, and now we are going ahead with our daily lives. Because somebody has come for the door. The watchman had come. Maybe he had to be paid, whatever. But this is the randomness of life. So the calling bell rang. And we already forgot about it. And we are taking our discussion somewhere else. But in a film, if you're having this particular thing, why the calling bell rang, you cannot leave it randomly. In a script, there has to be a reason. So when the bell rings, then everybody will want to know, boss, who's at the door? Then you open and you see that, okay, either your best friend has come or your lover has come or the bank guy has come to mortgage your property, whatever. The work is pretty much the same in all of them. Fiction is something that you can create. You can design. If it doesn't work, you can always go back and change. Documentary, you cannot do that. Documentary is realism. Documentary is what is actually happening. You cannot change the fact. Then it will not be a documentary. It will become a fiction. So when you're covering a certain situation, that is called a documentary. When you're making a documentary on a player or on an athlete, so there are things that the athlete does. Then, you know, those are reality. If you're making a film on, say, the migrant laborers in today's time, or if you're making a film on medical professionals, how they're going about doing their work. So these are things that are actually happening. You cannot say that, you cannot have your own interpretation of this thing. You may choose a particular way of life. You cannot say that, okay, can you tell me that again? Your voice was not clear. I'm sorry, if you have not got it the first time, then you will not get it again. Because that is the spontaneity or the randomness of the situation, which you have to be prepared for. So when therefore your approach has to be, you have to be prepared that, okay, these are the sounds. This is the kind of disturbance I will get there. You have to improvise on the spur of the moment. Because if I need to capture that particular moment, either by camera or by sound, I need to do a little bit of research about that place before I go in that, okay, at this particular time, this train comes over here. Now that could interfere with the interview that I'm doing over here with the character. So you have to time yourself in that way. This can also happen in feature films, that when you're shooting a feature film, then you know that, okay, we are on the flight path or we are on this thing, then these are the times that the aircraft will pass or the train will pass. So you have to finish anything before that or after that. In a documentary, unfortunately, you don't have that liberty. Whether the train passes or not, whether the flight passes or not, this person is talking something, saying something which is very valuable at that moment. You need to capture it. Okay. So your documentary, you have to move with the situation. It is not staged. You cannot create something. You have to capture whatever is playing in front of you. That is the thing. Game is again like fiction. It is in your control. You can create a very beautiful effect. You can design particular sounds which will make you feel that you're in that particular game. It can be a motor race game. It can be a whatever game that you're playing. It could be some chase sequel or some adventurer's game. So those kind of things make you feel that you're in part of the thing. When there's a sound that goes off, you turn around to react to that particular sound. These things create a kind of a suspense. And it involves you also. Yes. So when you're kicking a goal in your game, when you kick the goal, and the goal happens, there's automatically a cheer happening. It gives you that feeling that you've actually scored that game. So this adds to the drama. That approach again is a little driven in a different way. We are constantly hand in hand. So the editing of that particular scene and the sound, it all comes together. They benefit each other. I've seen a lot of loose edits, a lot of edits which, because they didn't have footage, it had to be edited in a certain way. We have covered it with sound, and that sort of problem was taken care of. Then there are also times when the sound influences the edit. Like, for example, the film that I'm working on involves a lot of action. So it's after an immediate action, like a truck rolling off a cliff and smashing down and scattering, and then immediately the next scene is a dialogue. So I had to sit with the director and the editor and say, no, we need to delay that next scene a little more, because the impact of that shatter will not be felt, and we have to pull that down in order to hear the dialogue. So it'll almost sound incomplete. So influence, these sort of things influence the sound. To the edit, it could be the length of the edit, it could be the length of that particular shot, either it needs to be increased or reduced. What happens is your perspective changes. When you're watching a silent film clip versus when you're watching a film clip with sound. When you're watching a silent film clip, say of 1 minute, you may feel very bored. You may feel that, it's really extending. It's 1 minute, but then it may make you feel that, oh God, it's going on forever. But the moment you have sound or music or, some audio element over there, the pace of that 1 minute is going to change. Either you will not notice how fast or quickly that 1 minute vanished, or you will feel that it's a proper 1 minute hand in hand going on. So these influences are constantly back and forth, is always happening. So we are all in conversation. I'm always in conversation with the editing department. They are always in conversation with me. The editing department is the one, when we do sync sound, the editing department is the one who actually selects the right takes and lays them down. And that makes our life easier, because we don't have to go and look for all the sounds that we had recorded in our sound bank. So you have, as an editor, already picked out those particular sounds and given me those particular handle lengths where I can trim it or increase it or decrease it. I will only go to my bank of location sounds if I find that I have a better take of that dialogue. Then I'll have to match it. I'm currently working on a Telugu film. I don't understand Telugu at all. I know a little bit of Tamil and Malayalam maybe, but I don't know Telugu at all. That has not stopped me, because the director had already briefed me about the film. He had told me about the story. He told me about the characters. I may miss out on nuances. I may miss out on certain dialogues and certain nuances, the way it is told and all that. But really, it does not affect me as much, because I have people translating to me that this is what the meaning of this word is, or if I am stuck about a certain thing. Because what happens is, even when we are discussing, if somebody is discussing in a different language and you're hearing that person talk, and suppose you're the only person in that room who does not understand that particular language, you don't really miss out on the conversation as much. You know what is being talked about. You may miss out on little details, because you will hear the vibe. You will get the vibe, whether what the discussion is, because it's all an emotional connect. So whether you're watching a film from South America, whether you're watching from a film in South India, or whether you're watching a film in wherever, China, the emotions, when the subtitles or the films are dubbed, the emotions are very, except for the language, we all have our gamut of emotions. There is anger, there is love, there is sorrow, so it is all revolving around that, around these emotions. Our lives in reality are, only the situation is different, the geography is different, the political setup is different. So these are the only things that are there. Maybe some little cultural differences, but by and large, what I've seen is, if you're working in the film and if you're seeing the film at least 300 to 350 times, you might even start learning the language. So it is not a hindrance. It is only communicating between amongst each other, which is becoming which could be an issue. Like if you're coming to Bombay, then you might have a problem from the south. Then language is a problem in terms of Hindi, but nobody's asking you to, recite Hindi over here. You just get basic knowledge and then you start working on the film. And very frankly, except for the dialogues, everything else is pretty much the same. So language is not so much of a barrier, because there will always be somebody to translate it for you. there's always going to be the director's assistants who will explain to you if you're stuck in some particular thing. So you are not really stuck. So if you become a doctor today, it does not mean that you're going to be running the neurology department of the topmost hospital in the country. No. It'll take you, if you have studied 7 years studying medicine, then it is going to take you maybe 20 years to reach that position. So that does not make you a lesser doctor or does not not qualify you for that. But there are various circumstances. Of course, it depends on your practice and how good you are at your work. And that happens, that applies to every aspect, whether you're coming from a management background or whether you're coming from an engineering background or whether you're coming from an arts background, whether you're coming in from an accounts background. So the rise or the thing is pretty much same. And it is as random as it can get. So it all depends on how you, it all depends on you. And of course, it depends on your knowledge. And it depends on a certain responsibility that you need to have. You have to weigh your priorities. You cannot, your attitude towards your work will define you and will see your growth. But having said that, I'm saying there are lots of avenues. One is the feature film industry. Now, feature film industry, there is regional and there is the Hindi film industry. So these are the two elements. Now, apart from regional and Hindi industry, you have the OTT platforms. So you have, you know, people making films for all these OTT platforms, whether it's Amazon, whether it's Netflix, whether it is Hotspot, where there are films that are happening all over. So all this, and there are web series happening. In those OTT platforms, you have web series, you also have web films. You also, you know, so, and there's so much of content that is being created now that there is going to be a constant demand for professionals working in the industry. And there is, of course, television. So you have these television channels. A lot of people take up jobs over there. They can take up journalistic jobs also if they are into journalism and stuff like that. So it depends entirely, because this is something, the beauty of this is you can do all of this. And especially for sound student, there's another department which does not at all depend on film, which is the music department. So you can be a song recording engineer and you can record music for bands. You can do live shows. You can do sound for live shows. You can specialize in music recording. And nowadays what happens is many big music composers have their own recording facility, have their own recording infrastructure. So a lot of people get absorbed in that also. So it depends. Now, if you are really wanting to get into song recording or music recording, then you have to know, to be able to be a good music recording engineer, you have to understand music. You have to know music to a certain extent. And it'll help you. The more you know music, the more closer you get to music, it'll help you rise in terms of, then people will start giving you more responsibilities. So it all depends on that. Now, having studied in an institution, you will automatically know your priorities. You will know where you're heading at or what interests you more. So again, like I said earlier, the proof lies in the pudding. Once you start doing the course, then you will automatically start making up your mind, okay, I want to go into this aspect. Having said that, this is, you need to have a certain level of technical background. You need to understand technology to a certain extent in order to get into a creative process. Having said that, there are also a lot of people who focus only on the technological part of it. So there are a lot of people who are wanting to get into research, into developing softwares, in developing different kinds of sounds, who are getting into the research aspect. So those who have a science background or who have a technical background and you want to get into that, this will also enable you to get into the process of creating software, like some of the this thing. There are products which are being sold. There are a lot of people who have joined companies like Avid, for example, or they are helping in development of softwares. And you know, what as a recording engineer or as a user, what are the things that you would prefer? And you are helping in developing that. A lot of people who are developing games. So you could probably also be absorbed into that process if you have a slightly technical bent of mind and you understand the aesthetics behind this. That is also a possibility. Thank you. Bye.